Marilyn Monroe remains to be one of the brightest stars in cinema. Today, she continues to capture the public interest with her very mythicized personal history. As a Marilyn stan, I find this rather sad. Beyond all those rumors and overblown stories is a rich film career and a smart woman who worked hard to get to the top. She had such a strong, unique screen presence that never failed to captivate anybody who witnessed her work. Unfortunately, this year hasn't been kind to Marilyn's memory, and I'm a little bit concerned. Apart from that disrespectful Kim Kardashian Met Gala debacle, which I have no desire to get into, the representation in the media that Marilyn has received in 2022 is a little bit worrisome. Earlier this year, Netflix released a pretty bad documentary about her that was built on gossip and hearsay. Finally, in the next few weeks, we're getting a quote-unquote biopic called Blonde, starring Ana de Armas. While I'm not against anybody trying to capture the essence of Marilyn on the silver screen, I'm scared that Blonde, which is based on a completely fictional Joyce Carol Oates novel, would only further complicate and exploit Marilyn's sad life. Look, I'm not knocking the film down before I see it. Who knows? It might be great. But most of the time, Hollywood biopics chooses artistic license over hard facts, which the general public usually accepts as the ultimate truth. After seeing the trailer for Blonde a few weeks ago, I started researching this video essay to myth bust all the misinformation that the movie might spread. However, halfway through my work, I felt just as exploitative. I stopped what I was doing and began to think of a way to pay tribute to Marilyn without publishing yet another YouTube video about her rumored romances, her supposed drug addiction, and the sexual abuse she experienced. Instead, I came up with the idea of paying homage by writing about something a little bit more positive: her rise into superstardom during the banner year of 1953. In this video essay, I'll be talking about Marilyn's ascent into popularity, the three films that made her a superstar, and how those movies affected her career. I won't be touching on anything too tragic unless I feel that it plays an important role in the 1953 narrative. What you won't find here is anything about drugs, the Kennedys, or useless gossip. However, I'll be touching on a few difficult parts of her life in relation to her career, such as her ongoing battle with Fox studio head Daryl Zanuck, the studio's decision to give her a dumb blonde persona, and the other ups and downs she experienced while trying to make it big. This is my love letter to Marilyn Monroe, and hopefully, you'll be able to appreciate her more without having to hear about the extremely tragic life details that have haunted her reputation for over 50 years. Before I discuss Marilyn's cinematic outputs of 1953, it's very important to know where she was in her career right before her ascent into superstardom. This story begins in 1949, when Marilyn Monroe was struggling to make ends meet. After months of work as a contract player at 20th Century Fox, she failed to get any major movie roles, resulting into the cancellation of her contract. In her autobiography, My Story, Marilyn notes that the studio head, Daryl F. Zanuck, let her go because he didn't see any star potential. She was unphotogenic, he said. Jobless and broke, Marilyn looked for opportunities around Hollywood. When her car was repossessed, she became very desperate. How could she go to auditions in LA without a car, she thought. To earn money to get her car back, Marilyn agreed to pose nude for photographer Tom Kelly. She was paid $50 for an image that was to be used for a calendar. While I did mention at the beginning of this video essay that I would avoid most of the tragic things that happened in Marilyn's life, this nude photoshoot is very important to mention because it plays a big role later. After countless auditions and rejections, Marilyn finally got her big break when she met talent agent Johnny Hyde of the William Morris Agency. He took a special interest in her career and promoted her all about town. In her book, Marilyn says that Johnny Hyde was one of the nicest men she would ever meet, and while he was in love with her, he never made aggressive sexual advances like most men did. He treated her with love and respect, and the two became very close. Johnny was invested in making her a star. Over at MGM, Marilyn's good friend Lucille Ryman, who worked as a talent scout for the studio, found out that they were producing a new John Huston movie called The Asphalt Jungle. She tipped Marilyn off, and Johnny Hyde got to work in getting her an audition. The actress was extremely nervous for the reading. After many, many years of hardships, she knew she had to do her very best. She prepared thoroughly, studying the script closely, rehearsing with her friend and acting coach Natasha Liddies. In the end, Huston was very impressed and hired her for the part. The Asphalt Jungle was a roaring critical success and made Marilyn feel like she was on top of the world. She was hungry for more. Johnny Hyde would then secure her another high-profile picture soon after, this time in Joseph L. Mankiewicz's backstage drama All About Eve in 1950. The movie would go on to win Best Picture at the Oscars. While her role in it is very, very small, Marilyn shines in the film. Her appearance in All About Eve would be moviegoers' first glimpse at the famous Marilyn persona they would fall in love with later. She played the ambitious and scattered-brained starlet Miss Caswell with great comic timing. Even with her limited screen time, she holds her own against a stacked ensemble of acting heavyweights like Betty Davis, George Sanders, and Celeste Holmes. Although Marilyn now had two good films on her resume, Zanuck still didn't see her star potential. He and the bigwigs at 20th Century Fox thought she'd simply be a flash in the pan. Despite this, they welcomed her back to the studio as a contract player. In the next 2 years, Fox would put Marilyn in a number of supporting roles or in low-quality, forgettable films. Some notable work includes her performance as the mentally unstable Nell Forbes in B-movie Don't Bother to Knock, and a ditzy secretary in Howard Hawks' comedy Monkey Business. Fox was undoubtedly trying to make her a certain type, the dumb blonde or the object of men's desires. This imposed type truly followed and shaped her public persona for years to come. For the record, Marilyn was far from being the dumb blonde she would portray in her movies. Between shots, she could be found reading or studying. By this time, she was finally making steady money, but spent her entire salary on books, dramatic lessons, and dance and singing classes. She even went to college to study classical art for a while before giving it up for her career. Despite getting unsubstantial movie roles, Marilyn embraced the work with pleasure. It was better than the poverty she had known her entire life. But even as a bit player in bad movies, Marilyn struck a chord with audiences. She was a scene stealer who radiated off the screen. Watch any of her early work and you will see why. For example, during my rewatch of Monkey Business, I was completely drawn to her. You'd think having legends like Cary Grant and Ginger Rogers on screen would be enough, but no, the film needed more Marilyn. She shines in a thankless role, and you notice that she really possessed that special quality that makes a movie star. The audiences of 1952 felt the same. "It surprised my employers much more than it did me," Marilyn wrote in her memoir. "Even when I had played only bit parts in a few films, all the movie magazines and newspapers started printing my picture and giving me write-ups." In early 1952, Marilyn's nude calendar came back to haunt her. When Wire journalist Eileen Mosby discovered that the rising starlet had posed nude a few years back, she broke the story. Initially, the studio tried to deny everything. However, Marilyn thought it was the wrong way to handle the situation. While she was scared that the scandal would end her career before it really began, she decided to own up to it instead. She made the right decision because the public stayed on her side. "Somehow, the story of the nude calendar pose didn't reflect scandal on me," she wrote. "It was accepted by the public for what it was, a ghost out of poverty rather than sin risen to haunt me." A few weeks after the story became known, I realized that far from hurting me in any way, it helped me. The public was not only touched by this proof of my honest poverty a short time ago, but people also liked the calendar by the millions. Fan mail started flooding into Fox by the thousands, and they were all addressed to one Miss Marilyn Monroe. Still, Zanuck remained unimpressed. He had bigger names to promote. Eventually, the amount of Marilyn's fan mail became too overwhelming for the studio. She was receiving 5 times more mail than the studio's reigning box office queen Betty Grable. After years of resistance, Zanuck finally caved in and called her into his office for a meeting. All I had to do, Mr. Zanuck said, was to trust him, Marilyn wrote. He would do everything that was best for me and help me to become a big star for the studio. I could tell that Mr. Zanuck didn't like me very much and that he still couldn't see any more talent or beauty in me than when he had fired me a year ago on the general grounds of being unphotogenic. Marilyn knew it was finally her time to shine. Her first substantial leading role was just on the horizon. She was finally going to fulfill her destiny, one she'd been dreaming of since childhood. Zanuck's unphotogenic girl was finally being given a shot. Marilyn Monroe's first big starring role came in the form of Henry Hathaway's Technicolor noir film, Niagara. Released in February of 1953, this was the first of three major Hollywood productions that year that Fox released to build up their rising new star. The idea of Niagara came to producer and screenwriter Charles Brackett when he realized that the vacation hotspot was rarely used in motion pictures, apart from the occasional newsreel and travelogue. He pitched the idea of a noir-style story to Zanuck, who loved the concept. Zanuck approved the film as long as it included a violent, nerve-wracking sequence on the rapids. Brackett agreed. Production began in mid-1952 with Marilyn Monroe, Joseph Cotten, Gene Peters, and Casey Adams rounding up the main cast. In the film, Marilyn plays Rose Loomis, a woman vacationing at the Niagara Falls with her temperamental husband, George, played by Joseph Cotten. When another young couple come to stay at the same motel for their honeymoon, they notice the strange tension between Rose and George. While George looks like the bad guy for most of the story, mainly because Rose plays victim whenever she's in public, it is later revealed that she and her young lover have actually been plotting to kill George off. As a way to market the film, Fox began a strong campaign to make Marilyn a sexual object, something that would follow her persona for the rest of her career. It's clear that the studio intended the film to be a crucial star maker for Monroe, wrote Robert Weston for Film Monthly. The preview and the poster for the film was emblazoned with superlative slogans like "a raging torrent of emotion that even nature can't control," or "when a man took her loveliness in his arms, he took his life in his hands." Or how about "Niagara and Marilyn Monroe, the two most electrifying sights in the world." Hollywood was creating the figure that would become its most enduring personality. The critics and movie-going audience ate the campaign right up. While many reviewers praise the film for being a unique technicolor noir, most films in this genre are shot in stark black and white, they often overlook Monroe's performance because of her beauty and sexual magnetism. Take for example this 1953 review from the New York Times. Obviously ignoring the idea that there are seven wonders of the world, 20th Century Fox has discovered two more and enhanced them with technicolor in Niagara. For the producers are making full use of both the grandeur of the falls and its adjacent areas, as well as the grandeur that is Marilyn Monroe. There was also this review from The Hollywood Reporter. They write, "Hathaway draws splendid performances from his cast and maintains a taut, spicy tempo that grips the attention consistently. Miss Monroe turns in her finest acting performance yet, adding to her acting laurels by playing a sexy tart with a provocative abandon that has a powerful impact." A sexy tart. Really? It's true that when you watch Niagara, it's impossible not to notice how luminous and beautiful Marilyn is in it. The fact is, she's a very attractive woman, and Joseph McDonald's cinematography makes her look like a screen goddess. Beyond the superficial, Marilyn truly churns out one of the most intriguing performances of her career. Finally given the opportunity to stretch her dramatic wings in a high-quality motion picture, the actress makes the most of it. Her portrayal of Rose is complicated and nuanced. She fearlessly brings life into this despicable, scheming, and self-serving character. Take for example the now iconic walk scene. When Rose hears her lover's secret song from the bells in the distance, her face and body language shows you who she really is. She doesn't care that she's the villain, as long as she gets what she wants. Even under the spell of acting coach Natasha Liddes, who told Marilyn to overpronounce her syllables, there is no denying that her work in Niagara is very, very good. It's a great performance that stands along well with many of her most iconic roles. The suggestive portrayal of both Marilyn and her character Rose stirred up some controversy in 1953. The AFI catalog notes that Variety reported various women's groups protested Marilyn's frank characterization in the film. Zanuck and Fox did not bat an eye. The box office receipts prove that no small scandal like that can harm the film and their new leading lady. The intense sexualization of Marilyn Monroe was just about to begin. Ultimately, Niagara proved to be a hit, grossing $2.3 million against a budget of $1.2 million. Marilyn was now receiving an average of 12,400 fan letters a month. The Hollywood wolves were happier than ever. I truly wish I could make this section on Niagara a bit longer and a little more detailed, but unfortunately, there isn't a lot of information online from reputable sources that I would feel comfortable enough to cite in this essay. Sadly, I wasn't able to find the book about the making of the film because it's been out of print for years. If you know something interesting about the film, please do share it in the comments below. For now, I'll just sit here and be happy that Marilyn was able to make the film at all. She is wonderful in it. And while it's quite sad that the studio only gave her a real shot after her nude scandal, I relish in the fact that she was able to prove Zanuck and Fox wrong about her star potential. In the end of the day, Marilyn's true fans come out as the winners. We finally got our Marilyn and her unique screen presence immortalized on the silver screen. Her next film will not only cement her as a Hollywood heavyweight, but also an iconic pop culture figure around the world. In 1925, writer Anita Loose published a magazine serial entitled The Diary of a Hasty Traveler in Harper's Bazaar. Later, this collection of stories about a gold-digging flapper girl named Lorelei Lee and her more level-headed brunette friend Dorothy Shaw would be the basis of a Broadway musical called Gentlemen Prefer Blondes in 1949. The show made a star of showbiz legend Carol Channing and it ran for 740 performances. Eventually, Fox bought the rights to the musical, intending it to be a vehicle for Betty Grable, their biggest star on the lot. However, Zanuck changed his mind in favor of Marilyn Monroe after realizing her salary was a lot smaller. For her brunette co-star, Howard Hughes' production company loaned out the more established Jane Russell, who had become a sex symbol in the 1940s after appearing in the controversial The Outlaw. The studio rolled out the red carpet for Russell, giving her a dressing room and welcoming her entire posse onto the lot. Russell earned a whopping $200,000 for the movie, while Marilyn was only to receive a total of $18,000 for her now iconic work. Marilyn talks about this time in one of her final interviews in 1962.
I remember when I got the card in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, Jane Russell. She was the brunette in it, and I was the blonde. She got $200,000 for it, and I got my $500 a week, but to me that was considerable. But the only thing was, I couldn't get a dressing room. And I said, I really got to this kind of a level. I said to them, I said, look, after all, I am the blonde, and this gentleman preferred blondes. Because they always kept saying, remember, you're not a star. I says, well, whatever I am, I'm the blonde. I mean, it got to that.
Despite the huge disparity in their salaries, the two women got along harmoniously during production. Contemporary articles say that they had a good relationship even after the press and studio tried to create a feud between them to drum up some publicity. Take, for example, this 1953 article by Jean Hansacker from the Daily Times. It reads, Jane says some gossip lovers have urged her, please, couldn't you and Marilyn have just a small beef and let me be the first to hear about it? But after 2 months' work on the picture, Jane calls Marilyn a nice, sweet kid. She works a lot harder than I do. As for the scene stealing, in all the years I've been in pictures, I have not run into that. Marilyn expresses equal esteem for Jane and calls her a good actress in the kind of thing she likes to do. Isn't it amazing and truly disgusting how the studio bigwigs tried to stir up a feud for PR? Pitting women against each other has been in fashion since the early days of Hollywood. In this case, it was the new blonde sex symbol versus the aging brunette one. Luckily, Jane and Marilyn didn't indulge the wolves, even when this particular production marked the beginning of Marilyn's erratic and often unprofessional on-set behavior. I won't go too much into detail, but many sources have cited that Marilyn started coming to work very late during this period. She would also ignore Howard Hawks' direction and instead sought out the advice of her acting coach Natasha Liddes, who was on set all the time. I've referenced Marilyn's book My Story a lot in this video, and I highly recommend you read it if you want to know a little bit more about this. Marilyn writes in detail why she often went to work late. It's very revealing and tells you exactly how much of an insecure person she was. Despite all of this, Jane Russell remained absolutely good-spirited and kind to her co-star. In later interviews, Russell never exploited Marilyn's story and always talks about her with affection.
Oh, I liked Marilyn very much. She was very shy, and I never saw anybody work harder in my life. All through lunchtime, she had her head in the book or in the script, and at night she would go and work with her coach. Well, if you've ever followed someone around making a motion picture, it's a tough day, and at the end of the day, you're good and tired. But Marilyn would go to her coach and work for two or three more hours. And when we were dancing, when we were doing all the rehearsals, the dance rehearsals, she just worked and worked and worked. And she felt like she was going to do it in spite of them.
In the film, Marilyn and Jane play a pair of showgirls. Marilyn is Lorelai Lee, a ditzy blonde engaged to a papa's boy millionaire. Jane is her sensible best friend, Dorothy Shaw, who is asked to chaperone Lorelai on a cruise to France, where she plans to meet and marry her fiancé away from his father's disapproving eyes. However, wackiness ensues on board when Lorelai meets a gullible diamond miner and Dorothy falls in love with a penniless private eye investigating her troublemaking friend. Gentlemen Prefer Blondes premiered in August 1953 with mixed to positive reviews. Contemporary reviewers agreed that the film was just frivolous musical entertainment spearheaded by two great female stars. And as you've probably guessed, the male critics mostly focus on Marilyn and Jane's looks and sex appeal. Together, the two femmes are the picture's outstanding assets for exploitation purposes and entertainment, wrote William Brogdon for Variety. Miss Russell is a standout and handles the lines and songs with a comedy flair she has previously demonstrated. Miss Monroe matches with a newly displayed ability to sex a song as well as point up the eye value of a scene by her presence. Then there was Bosley Crowther of the New York Times, who wrote, "And yet there is that about Miss Russell and also about Miss Monroe that keeps you looking at them even when they have little or nothing to do. Call it inherent magnetism. Call it luxurious coquetry. Call it whatever you fancy. It's what makes this a buoyant show." Regardless of the mixed critical reaction, Gentlemen Prefer Blondes was met with great enthusiasm by the movie-going public. It would go on to gross $5.3 million at the box office, becoming the 7th highest earner of the year. If Niagara introduced Marilyn to the world as a rising star, Gentlemen Prefer Blondes made her an established one. Unfortunately, the sexy, dumb blonde persona that Fox had fostered as early as 1950 would be associated with her forever after her performance as the gold-digging Lorelai Lee. Old Hollywood, as we all know, likes to put their stars in a box to make them a certain type. Bette Davis is the Spitfire Yankee, Audrey Hepburn is the modern-day Cinderella, Grace Kelly is the icy blonde, and Marilyn is the ditzy sex bomb. From this point onward, she was Lorelai Lee to the public consciousness. She would have a hard time getting serious roles after Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. Even when she radically left Hollywood a few years later to study at the Actors Studio in New York, Marilyn was never considered by her peers or her studio as a serious actress. To them, Marilyn was Lorelai. Lorelai was Marilyn. Maureen Turam said it best in her 1978 article, Gentlemen Consume Blondes. She writes, "Marilyn Monroe / Lorelai Lee, star persona and character, are flattened into a single myth. Even the 20s locutions which remain, like Thank You Ever So, became simply another of Marilyn's idiocracies, part of her essence as instantaneous artifact and pop art sex goddess, part of the arsenal along with quivering lips and dresses drawn tight across the hips. Honestly, this just comes to show how good Marilyn was at her job. She was able to embody the character of Lorelai Lee so seamlessly that people couldn't see anything else. As the titular blonde, the actress is a hoot from start to finish. Her comedic timing is impeccable, her line readings are hilarious, and her subtle facial expressions shows you just how in control she is with the characterization. Sure, the story and role might not be as nuanced as, let's say, Judy Holliday's version of the ditzy blonde in Born Yesterday, but Marilyn 100% understood the musical comedy assignment. It is a perfectly calibrated comic performance that really should have been more celebrated for what it is. Brilliant. It's unfortunate that her dazzling work here was once again overshadowed by a persona that people, and by that I mean men, couldn't take seriously. Luckily, times have changed and many modern-day viewers have re-evaluated the film and performance as one of Marilyn's very best, and rightfully so. There are even scholars now who have defended the film's seemingly sexist attitude towards women as a triumphant feminist satire made during the conservative 1950s. Before moving on, I'd just like to mention the cultural impact Gentlemen Prefer Blondes has had on pop culture. The movie has been parodied or homaged countless of times in films, television, magazines, and even by pop stars like Madonna. Marilyn Monroe singing the popular Diamonds Are a Girl's Best Friend in her bright pink dress is easily one of the most recognizable images in pop culture history. Marilyn's unmatched stardom and stunning performance has truly made Gentlemen Prefer Blondes endure as a true old Hollywood classic. Her next film in 1953, released later in the fall, would be even bigger, becoming Fox's second highest grossing film for the entire year.
Thank you very, very much. Marilyn, this is your first appearance in television, isn't it?
Yes, it is, Jack.
Well, I'm quite flattered that you made your first appearance on my show.
Thank you. I really am.
Just wonderful to have you. Have you a picture that's coming out pretty soon, a new picture? I mean, we've seen Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. Another one, new one?
Yes, it's called How to Marry a Millionaire. It's also in CinemaScope.
Oh, it is. In CinemaScope, too.
Yes.
You know, I made a picture once. The horn blows at midnight. And I believe if that had been made in CinemaScope, it would have been a huge success.
Well, you know, CinemaScope is very complicated. Mm-hmm. In order to put the big screen in all the theaters, they have to take out a lot of seats.
Mm-hmm. Well, in my picture, they could have taken out all of the seats.
Jack, what? I don't know why you're always panning the horn blows at midnight. I saw it.
You did?
Yes.
And you don't know why I'm panning it? Did you like it?
No.
Well, thanks ever so. So long. Goodbye, Marilyn.
By the 1950s, Hollywood had a new enemy. It was called television. Box office receipts were down as people preferred to experience entertainment in the comforts of their own home. Tinseltown was scrambling to find the next big thing that would get butts into movie theater seats. In comes anamorphic CinemaScope, which, in layman's terms, is what we know today as the widescreen format. Hollywood creatives became hopeful that they could draw audiences back to cinemas with epic sensory experiences on larger, longer screens. Fox got to work by greenlighting two new films into production. The first was the biblical epic The Robe, and the second would be a fun romantic comedy called How to Marry a Millionaire, based on two plays called The Greeks Had a Word for It and Loco. While How to Marry a Millionaire was the first to finish production, Fox held out on releasing it to theaters until The Robe premiered. Both films have the honor of being noted as two of the most financially successful pictures of 1953. The Robe took the top spot, while Millionaire was ranked at fourth place, earning a little over $7 million in the box office. These Fox releases are considered to have saved the studio from the financial ruin that television had put them in. Soon, their success would prompt other studios to follow suit, adopting widescreen as a common practice in Hollywood filmmaking. Fresh off the success of Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, Marilyn was finally on top. However, she didn't know that How to Marry a Millionaire would shoot her into a different level of superstardom. The lighthearted romp was a clear people pleaser. Even hard to please New York Times film critic Bosley Crowther called the film an entertainment you can't afford to miss. Oh, but don't get too excited, because he calls all three leading ladies dumb blondes and then trashes CinemaScope at the latter part of his review. But generally, reviewers saw the movie as a fun time at the picture show. Even Marilyn noted the success of the film in her memoir. She writes, "I finally went into Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, and after that, How to Marry a Millionaire. I like doing these pictures. I like the fact that I was important in making them a great financial success, and that my studio cleaned up a fortune despite that its chief had considered me unphotogenic. I like the fact that the movie salesman who came to Hollywood for a big studio sales rally whistled loudest and longest when I entered their midst. I like the raise I finally received, the $1,200 a week. Even after all the deductions were taken from my salary, it remained more money a week than I had once been able to make in 6 months. I had clothes, fame, money, a future, all the publicity I could ever dream of. I even had a few friends, and there was always romance in the air. Marilyn was finally a Hollywood it girl." How to Marry a Millionaire was a great success for its other two leading ladies as well. Lauren Bacall, who hadn't made a film in 3 years, was set on proving that she still had that star factor that made her famous in the 1940s. Primarily known as a dramatic actress, she also wanted to prove that she had the capacity of doing light-hearted comedies. On the other hand, Betty Grable, who was Fox's biggest draw during World War II, wanted to leave the studio with a bang. Millionaire marked her final contractual film with Fox. The three make comic gold playing New York City models hunting for millionaire husbands. Bacall plays the sassy Shotzi Page, who resists a secretly wealthy young suitor for an elderly gentleman. Grable plays the fun-loving Loco Dempsey, who, despite all efforts, falls in love with a poor mountain ranger. Finally, Monroe is Pola DeVoice, who is practically blind but refuses to wear glasses in the presence of men. If you haven't seen this film, you can just imagine how funny Marilyn is when she's put in situations where she sacrifices her sight for beauty. Once again, she shows a great flair for physical comedy, which she never really gets credit for. By all accounts, the three stars got along together very well. In later interviews, Bacall would talk about Marilyn's behavior, which was similar to what she had done on the set of Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. While she was irritated with the unprofessionalism, Bacall says that she felt Monroe's inner sadness and desperation. This prompted herself and Betty Grable to make an effort to be friendly and welcoming to the young star. But even with all the camaraderie, the press once again tried to create a feud between the women. TCM published the quote from an April 1953 letter from director Nonnally Johnson to his friend Thornton Delahanty. It reads, "Everybody went around with their fingers in their ears blabbering about what temperament there would be on set, and needless to say, the gossip columnists, those lice, have done everything possible to foment trouble for us. They've printed all kinds of mischievous rumors, quoting one against the other, and printing out fictitious privileges given to one above the other two, in the most desperate effort you ever saw to create feuds, but it hasn't worked in the least." Personally, I think How to Marry a Millionaire stands out amongst Marilyn's films because it's really quite special seeing three legendary actresses of this caliber share the screen in such unity. They never hug the camera, and they do what is best to serve the story. During the height of the golden age of Hollywood, it was very rare to see big-name actresses in the same movie. They are often put in their own star vehicles or delegated as the secondary lead to the male characters. How to Marry a Millionaire is nothing of the sort. The film is the story of three women who take their futures into their own hands. Though you can argue that the film's premise hasn't exactly aged well in the lens of 2022, you can't take away the fact that the film is a wonderful comical look at the values of 1950s womanhood. And these women aren't complacent or bossed around. They are women with actual agency. In fact, looking over all three of Marilyn's 1953 films, you will notice the theme of agency between them. Her work as Rose in Niagara may be villainous, but she knows exactly what she wants and she goes out to get it. Her Lorelei Lee is known as a dumb blonde, but is actually putting up a front to get the finer things in life. As her character says near the end of the film, "I can be smart when I want to be, It's also curious that all three of these films feature more than one woman in leading roles during a time that wasn't necessarily a norm. Even in Niagara, Jean Peters' role as Polly Cutter seems more important than any of the men. What does this teach us in relation to Marilyn's early career? That women-led pictures have the capacity to be extremely successful, and studios don't need to make up phony feuds for this to happen. Unfortunately, almost 70 years later, Hollywood still operates the same way. Pay disparity, the sexualization of young women and men, and bad publicity feuds are still very much evident today. With the exemption of 1954's There's No Business Like Show Business, which is clearly built for Ethel Merman, Marilyn never again shared the screen with a female equal. Big enough to headline a film on her own, she became the sole star of all her pictures. Women cast in her movies often played wise-cracking sidekicks, which, I think, is really quite sad. Some of Marilyn's best work was in the company of women, and I could only imagine how awesome it would have been if she was given great scripts with other fantastic leading actresses. Imagine if we had a musical extravaganza starring Marilyn and Carmen Miranda, or a great romantic comedy with Rita Hayworth. Fox could have had even bigger hits. But in some ways, this missed opportunity was Marilyn's fault too. After her banner year, she was given a lot more power. She was able to be pickier with her scripts and was even given director approval. I truly hope you learned a lot about Marilyn Monroe's early career from this video. Her life and film work is really quite remarkable, even when at times it's overshadowed by tragedy. 1953 was just the beginning of an outstanding career that produced a number of true classics. Some of my personal favorites include Billy Wilder's Some Like It Hot, the ultra-meta drama The Misfits, and even Let's Make Love, which people usually brush off as one of her lesser performances. Today, Marilyn's memory lives on through her fans and her glorious cinematic work. Next time you see her on screen, don't think about the pills. Don't think about her failed romances. Don't think about JFK or Joe DiMaggio. Don't think about Kim Kardashian. Think about Marilyn Monroe.